bye-bye.
Can I take it out? Oh, can I take it out? No, I shouldn't take it out. That's no better if you give me this one. Yeah, I should have asked you before, but I forgot. Can I get the mic there? No, but then it falls on my laptop. Give me that. Oh, good. Is it long enough? Is it? Good. That's good. Yes. Hello. So this was the song "Hyper Hyper" by Scooter, a German band. And what I really like about this song is the lyrics and also the video. And I like the lyrics because they're very pragmatic. So the song starts with a question. Is everybody on the floor? Because they cannot see because they have lights in their face, so they cannot see the audience. So is everybody on the floor? Yeah, no, should we get started? Yeah, okay, good. Then the song explains what the band is going to do. It's going to put some energy into this place so you know what to expect. And also, the end goal, I want to see you sweat. So this is what they will see. Then it's nice, they make an appreciation of the audience. It's so beautiful to see your hands in the air, but I wonder if they couldn't see the audience, how can they see the hands in the air? Well, that's another question, but. Then it's very interesting, this middle part, you know, like for such a big single, maybe the people who are younger among of you, they don't know, but this was a huge, it was a big single. Was it, Jens, right? It was a big single, hit single, right? And I find it interesting that in such a big song, you know, very famous song, you have this part where they give a big shout out to all ravers in the world and also to our speakers. And but my favorite part is the ending when it goes, sit there, be good, bye-bye. I mean, a song ending with bye-bye, you know, isn't that nice? I mean, how many songs do end, you know, they end with bye-bye, you know? Anyway, HyperTalks. My name is Lorenzo Pilia. I'm the program manager of the festival. And for the fourth year in a row, I've got the big, big pleasure of hosting the HyperTalks. And very soon, you'll be hearing five talks, 5 minutes each. But before we get started, I've got some thank yous. First of all, of course, the speakers. Without speakers, there would be no HyperTalks. It would only be making an intro Scooter video and then 90 minutes of silence. Then Nomi, also known as the Nomi, who she modified the video. So the video you saw, the video from Scooter, she made the part with the names of the speakers. And a big thank you to Nomi, because every time I've got one of these stupid ideas, I tell Nomi and she never tells me this stupid idea. She just, when she can, she helps and she does this sort of stuff. And then Robert, who's not here because I think he's doing his driving license, he's one of the technicians here from the venue, the Aubentaucher, and also the other people from Aubentaucher. When they're here, they're very good. When I can block them and ask them to do something. When they're not here, it's a bit of a problem, but yeah, we're getting to know each other. And SIA, without them, it would be just. But thanks to SIA, then you can hear me, so without them also, this wouldn't be possible. Then my PAs, where is Sven? My personal assistant, Sven, ciao. Masha, I don't know if she's here, I hope she's here, I hope she can see us. Thank you for your patience assisting me during the setup of the whole event, and also last but not least, the amaze team, all and each one of you, but in particular Merle and Marie, I have big pleasure of working with them, and seriously, none of this would have happened without their hard work. Actually, I have a representation here of how the city of Berlin would look like without Merle and Marie on board. Would be a bit like this, so yeah, so they really the ones who make it happen, because Thorsten and me only, this wouldn't happen, but it would be like this. Okay, so when you see them, Merle Marie, but also the others, the volunteers, everybody go say thank you when you see them, and let's have an applause for them. Cool, now time is over, HyperTalks, thank you, see you next year. No, now let's get started. We start with Fakhra AlMansouri, a game designer, caramel appreciator, and future astronaut. Yes, she's the founder and CEO of Hybrid Humans, the first independent game studio in Abu Dhabi, in the United Arab Emirates. And She's passionate about creating video games experiences that matter. And Fakhra is going to give us a look into the Emirates' local game dev scene, from independent studios to teams, solo devs, and the challenges they face. So let's please welcome on stage Fakhra AlMansouri. Do you want to use this or that?
All right.
Which one do you prefer?
I'll take this one.
Good.
Or this one.
You sure? This one?
Yeah.
Good. Need to open the file and set a reminder. To this. Look at this. Good yeah. Time here.
That's excellent. That's what we want to do.
Yes. And you're good to go. Let you see what you get.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you, Lorenzo. And thank you, everyone, for being here. So yeah, as the title suggests, my talk will be about hybrids and bridging communities. My name is Fakhra. I'm a game designer, and I absolutely love what I do, from creating video games to hosting workshops and organizing events back home. And yeah, I've started a game studio called Hybrid Humans. We're based in UAE. Oddly enough, we are the first independent Emirati game studios in the city. And this is our cozy space. And these are our published games. We've worked on Hub Hub Away, a puzzle adventure game that portrays the animal's condition in entertainment business, specifically bunnies and circus. And our second game is a Who Lurks, is a local multiplayer game. We wanted to bring back the deception board game experience to the most popular device that people use. So we want to create this social game experience. And our current is that okay? And our last project was a sewing simulator for an art exhibition back home. It was called Emirati Adornment. And some pictures. Our current project is Falcon Action. It's a competitive game, online racing multiplayer with some rhythm elements. We're experimenting with this game and we're developing this publicly. Some pictures, and here are the team behind those games. From left, it's Ali and Luke, and we're celebrating our third birthday in February. And Henry just joined us from Brazil just last week, so yay, Henry. And so let's go with the bigger picture and talk about the game scene in the UAE. It's quite a big market for video games and for gamers. We're one of the top countries that buy and play games. But as an indie game community, it's quite small and tiny. We're only a handful of us. So I've been organizing the Global Game Jam for 4 years in the UAE, hosting the event. And I also do Emirates Skills. It's a national competition. I do the game development. We also participate in Comic-Con. This is the biggest pop culture event back home. It's such a big, diverse group of people, as you can see from these pictures. And I've been talking with the organizers to have a pavilion for indie game devs. And that's where I want your help with that. And there are some pictures of these events through the years. Here's Games 15 and IGN. And recently, we had DGC. This is the only event I've seen that focuses on game development, but they've approached it in the wrong way, I think. They've just sold services like localization, publishing. I think that's the wrong way to do it in such a small community for indie game devs. But the indie-friendly one was Dubai Game Expo, which is happening in 3 weeks in Abu Dhabi now. It'll be featuring indie developers and some talks. And the most friendliest event was AMAs that happened last year in Abu Dhabi. And I got to meet some really awesome people over there. Sadly enough, we had only a handful of attendees. So here I'd like to spotlight some local developers from the country. We'll start with Asadir. His name is Mohammed, and he's working on a game called Roses Will Rise. It's a strategy RPG game with a female protagonist based in a fantasy world. He's working on this on his own, from art to music to everything. His game is available on Itch.io to download for free, and you can check out his progress. And you can support him on his Patreon. Our second developer is Hint. She is working on Black Crystals. It's a hand-drawn, character-driven JRPG with a point-and-click element. And here are some of her art. playable demo of this game will be ready at the end of the year. If you are into these kind of games, you can follow her and support her on her Tumblr and Twitter page. And last but not least is Catch Cool Games. This is a newly established game studio run by a few guys, one of which I've met 3 years ago at a workshop that I was doing. And he had a bunch of questions, and his goal was to establish a game studio, and he actually did that this year. So I'm really happy that he went ahead with his dream. He's working on a game called Sheeple, an action RPG game, and you can follow their progress on Kashkool Games. It's fairly new, so I don't know anything about the game just yet. So I want to talk briefly about the challenges. The challenges that we have over back home are the lack of understanding for the gaming industry. People don't really know what is the nature of game dev. So funding opportunities is really hard to come, no grants and no support from investors, because they expect it to be like a Minecraft thing, or a mobile game with like racing cars, something very not very mindful, I think. So building a sustainable, healthy community is not really possible there. Also, the world does not know about us. They think we're very isolated on an island. Media portrayal of like any Arab and Muslim countries or any community is terrible. So with your help, I would like to bridge that gap, and I want to invite you to attend our events to showcase your work. It's a great market for gamers, and I want people to be inspired by the work that you guys do, tell your stories. So if you are interested, please contact me on this, find me on Twitter, or we can talk about anything, basically. And I would like to leave you with this.
Shake your hands. Shake your hands and watch yourself.
Wait, Dad.
So this was 3 weeks ago at Comic-Con, so yeah, please come over if you want to. Thank you.
Jana? Where's Jana? Where's Jana? Hey, how's it going? All good? I think the timer turns off before the 5 minutes, so that's not very useful, huh? If the screen turns off, you should. No, it's okay. We give you a bit more time. Actually, we calculate together the time, so you need to see until. Anyway, our next speaker is Jana Reinhardt, which is here, as I know, and. She is the design half of Rat King, a game studio based in Halle, Germany. And her game, Solitude, formerly known as Solitude, was one of my favorite games from last year. And it's also nominated for our Amaze Awards. So you can play it over there at Urban Spray today, tomorrow, the day after. And the game, there's a very interesting story behind the game. So I asked Jana to come talk a little bit for 5 minutes about it. So let's please welcome on stage Jana Reinhardt.
Which one do you want? Which one do you prefer?
This. Okay. This one? Is it on? Okay.
Is it on?
Is it on? I think. It's not. No, it's on. Okay. Hi, I'm Jana Reinhardt. Like Lorenzo said, my game's name is Solitude. And in my talk, I want to talk about what inspired Solitude and why we made a completely different game from this research for the game. So last year or something about this, I was on a point where I was very unhappy with my life. I was very frustrated with the kind of games I did and with how indie games are. And that's a good time to unpack your escapist fantasies, like a plan B to exit game development, what I would do. And I don't have such a plan. I'm a game designer, and that's what I want to do. But when I was in a train, and I was passing a wandering shepherd there, I thought, that's it, I want to be a shepherd. And this actually created like a flashback back to my childhood, and I remembered where I came from. I'm from a very, very small village, and there was a shepherd always around, a whole family. They are shepherding like for generations. And I realized how completely detached I am from this place and from what I was there. So, shepherding. And I not only fell in love with the idea of becoming a shepherd, but it's completely illusional, of course. It's not my alternativity, but I got nuts on the research. I read books about it. I followed shepherds on Twitter. Yes, they tweet when they are out there. I did everything. I watched, they are serious, even in British and stuff, all about shepherds. And I also, of course, decided I want to do a game about shepherds. And this actually helped me. It distracted me from my self-doubt. And I did what I'm good at or what I love. I did games, and I wanted to do a game about shepherding. At the same time, we coincidentally met this guy on a bike trip around Halle, where I live, where I work. And I thought this is just some old dude with sheep around. And we talked to him. And then we did research on him. His name is Martin Binz. We searched for him, and he's like actually pretty famous. He's one of the most famous German shepherds. There are so many articles and interviews with him, and he's also the winner of a national sheep contest. We were baffled by this. And he told us, yes, there are sheep contests. They are held here, or not here, but you know, in Halle. They're around, and quite often. So we went to such a contest. To do research on the for the shepherding game. So this is how they work. They are like 4 to 5 guys. It's the whole day. And they got like a flock of sheep, like 300 sheep, and they guide them with 2 dogs. And it's a parkour, so they have to guide the sheep, make them comfortable, tell them where they have to grass, guide them past cars that drive by, stuff like this. And it's also the most relaxing contest I've ever seen. It's really, when you get a chance, go there. It's amazing. Also, people are super open-minded because they're really passionate. You just ask about shepherding and they tell you everything. They love it. It's so great. But it also showed one thing. I called it sheep cred. You see who is a shepherd and who's not. It's really very visually. You have to earn being a shepherd, and they show it. You got the staff, you got a hat, you got the clothes, like you see on the right with the buttons. So it's not a dress up. You don't get a shepherding staff when you're not a shepherd. And it's also a privilege having such a big flock of sheep. Not everybody can get it. It's actually pretty hard becoming a shepherd. Most of them, they grow up in a shepherding family, or they get one of the rare jobs at farms. So much about my little escapist fantasy about simply becoming a shepherd. So before I went there, I wanted to do the shepherding game I told you, and I wanted to do the game about an old guy who would alone walk with his sheep. And then I met a bunch of young girls who are all apprentices, a complete class of female shepherds. And they told me about their world, about their few being shepherds in this. Yeah, it's still a very manly place, but they talked about that, about their passion, that they want to be shepherds too, and about how hard it is to get in there. And I realized, why the hell do I do a game about a male shepherd? It's such a cliche. But after meeting the girls, I completely changed my idea about the shepherding game, and that's how I changed that's how I changed Solitude. And I didn't make a shepherding game, but I make a shepherding game about escapism. And that you really have to earn your path out. So my learning about Solitude, get really nuts on something, get invested, clear your head, and then make something completely different. Thank you.
Thank you, Jana. Adrian, are you staying here for the entire session, or do you have to leave? Huh?
No, I'm staying.
Okay. How much charge do you have on your iPhone?
100%.
Great, because I don't. Can you do a favor to me? Set it, because I need to set the 5-minute thing, but my screen turns off and I have little battery. So you do it, and my next session you give me the phone, and we leave the phone here, and then we give it back to you, okay? And Adrian made a game called Hidden Folks, which you should buy in exchange for the cards. It's a good game. It's a good one. Thank you, Adrian. Please do this because I need it for the next talk. If you can do it now, because I don't remember where I should do this, and I only have 11. Okay. Thank you. No big deal. But you need to turn off the auto thing, because otherwise, before 5 minutes, it turns off the screen. But that's my problem.
Okay. I'll
you can do it quick?
Yeah, I can do it quick.
Sit there.
You can start.
Don't stay in front. But yeah, I know, but then, because we're filming, and then in the final video of the talk, there will be you in front, and Lindsay start to talk. Anyway, take your time. You're using yours? Ah, she's using yours. No, but I need it for the next ones. I still need it for the next ones. So it's not so urgent, Adrian. The next speaker, not this one. Thank you. So coming up next, we got Lindsay, Raymakers, who she's a HyperTalk veteran now. She gave a HyperTalk, the same HyperTalk, last week at the Nordic Game Jam. And Lindsay started making video games through game jams, and one game a month. And she spent a year visiting many game events across Europe as she finished her degree. And for many years, she has been writing poetry as an emotional outlet. And now she's interested in how game development can be a medium for self-expression. And that's exactly what she's going to talk about today. So let's give a big applause to Lindsay Raymakers.
Hello? Oh, it works. Hi. I'm going to talk very briefly about game development as self-expression. So what do I mean when I say self-expression? It can have many, many meanings, but I'm going to talk specifically about expression of emotion, and you can sort of generalize it to any kind of, artistic expression or expression of ideas or impression of scenes, etc. So usually when people are, when you want to express something, you're having all these emotions and you feel, I want to have some kind of creative outlet for it. Maybe some people will turn to poetry, they'll write poetry, or some people will paint, some people will make music, some people will dance it out. There's many different ways that you can express yourself. And I've noticed that a lot of people have started to make video games as a form of expression. So I got really interested in this. And I'm not talking about the player being in a game and expressing themselves, but I'm talking about the developer making a game as a form of expression. So the first game I played that made me think about this, that this was something I could do, was Gravitation by Jason Rohrer. And this game is about balancing parenthood with doing creative projects. But for me, the game was about depression. And the game lasts about 6 minutes. And it was over, before it was over, I was crying, and I thought that was quite significant. So I started looking at games that were similar to it, because I was very interested in doing this as well. And at some point I came across Depression Simulator, and this is basically a very artistic walking simulator, and it's very uncomfortable, but that was the point, of course. And I thought it was also a very powerful experience. Then another example is What Now by Ariel Grimes. And this was also very powerful for me. It's a game about mentally breaking down and about about being overwhelmed and not being able to function anymore. So I highly recommend you to check them out. But what you can see from these examples is that they don't really tell a story. There's maybe some story in it, but they're more about some internal experience, about some emotion. And I think that's really, really amazing. If you compare it, for example, to this painting, I would interpret it as someone who's angry. Maybe you have a different interpretation. But if you see these games, they also have this emotion that they're showing, but you can interact with it, and you can sort of explore this thing that someone experienced, or at least their artistic representation of it. So not everyone will really like these games. Not everyone will make them, for sure. But this is what happens in all mediums. I'm using literature because I write a lot of poetry, and that's what I'm most familiar with. Not everyone writes poetry. Not everyone reads books. Not everyone likes long-form games, like games that last hundreds of hours or 20 hours even. Everyone has their own taste in the media that they consume, and also in what they create. So for some people, maybe this will be poetry, which I've been doing for a while. But now I'm really like looking into making these small games instead of writing poetry. And I think there's something very unique about it as a creator doing this. Because when you think about, oh, how do I put this emotion, like depression or something else, maybe it's happiness. Yeah, it doesn't have to be negative. When you make a game about it, you really start to think, what are the mechanics of this emotion? How do I put this into game mechanics? And this can teach you something about yourself. And I think that's a super interesting process as a creator. So maybe the next time when you feel like, oh, I want to make some like artistic thing, I want to express myself in some way, maybe try to make a game about it and see how that works for you. Maybe you like it, maybe you won't, that's okay. And then maybe you maybe share it, maybe don't. Like if you're not comfortable with it, you don't have to. There's a ton of poetry I've written, a ton of really bad poetry, hopefully some good ones, or some I'm really happy about. And some I'll publish, some I will never see the light of day. So just create stuff and yeah, see what works for you. So yeah, if you do this, I would be super interested in talking to you about it, or yeah, just get in touch. And yeah, thank you.
Oops. Thank you, Lindsay. Thank you. Oh, it's gone. Oh, I broke it. I thought I broke it. Thank you. Thank you. Adrian, it works great. Perfect. And you can tell Adrian is a smart person because also without me telling him, he also put the phone in plain mode. So yes, well done. But I knew it already. Yes. So our next speaker is Charlotte Madelon, yes, good, thank you. And she's a self-taught game developer. She graduated cum laude, congratulations, in 2016 from the Utrecht School of Arts, and she now focuses full-time on the production of Lily, modeling, designing, and programming the entire game. With a curiosity for psychology, health, and art, her aim is to create meaningful and entertaining games. Today, she will show us how science and the Dutch old masters are helping her to create the game. So let's please welcome on stage Charlotte Madelon.
Yeah, sure.
Second, we need to set up.
Okay.
Go open the file. I need to go open the file. So get a feeling of the. How's it going? Yeah, it's good. 5 minutes. It's going to be. Also, if you give a good talk, you get a free phone.
Okay, cool. Yes.
Offered by.
Yes.
And a promo code for Hidden Folks as well.
Yay.
It's good. It's a good phone, huh? Yes. It's happy. It's PowerPoint. Look at that. Beautiful. Cody, this is your current one?
Yes.
And I set here the thing.
Okay. Okay, hello everyone. I'm Charlotte Madelon and I made Lily. It's a small game about how humans convert childhood trauma into organic disease later in life. And I made a human-like flower inspired by the white lily. So here you can see the brain and this is the mouth, for example. And in this game you can unfold every flower and every leaf. Or you can move around certain body parts like the roots or the intestines if you want to see them like that. And in this flower there are all kinds of insects and creatures hidden, which represents the diseases and high-risk behaviors humans can get later in life when you are exposed to childhood trauma. So basically, you unfold the flower and you try to find every creature, and this way I hope you learn something about that this problem. And I want to talk about one of the inspirations of mine, which are the Dutch old masters and how they are helping me to design Lily. So during the golden age, the artists in Holland weren't no longer supported by the church, so they could choose every kind of topic they wanted. So they painted a lot of landscapes and the cities and or the countryside on the farms, but also a lot of anatomical lessons. And this is a very famous one by Rembrandt van Rijn. In Holland, these dissections were public events, so everyone could visit them. Here on the right, you see the theater in Delft, where doctors would show how to dissect people. And the doctors didn't dissect them because they wanted to determine the cause of death or for medical purposes, but simply because they were very curious how the human body worked. And the artists used their craft to make this knowledge and science very beautiful and very accessible to the rest of the people. And this is kind of my logic why I am choosing dissecting as a mechanic for the game. So every human has organs, and when you slice them open, they come out, and this is a fact of reality. So for me, portraying human organs means to look objectively at truth. And when you're making something about childhood trauma, you can get overwhelmed by emotions or conflict. So this is for me a way to make something about that. And the Dutch old masters really inspired me. So my game doesn't show the science about the human body, but about how childhood trauma affects the body. And I chose this study from the mid-90s, the Adverse Childhood Experience Study, which was done across 70,000 people. And they asked about these 10 categories, if the people experienced them. So abuse, household challenges, or neglect. And for every category answered with a yes, they would get 1 point, also as one ACE score. So for example, if someone was emotionally abused, emotional neglected, physical neglected, and lived with a parent who was an alcoholic, they would get an ACE score of 4. And then they asked these people about their current health status, and which you found was the more traumas you get, the more chance of developing cancer or heart disease or depression, etc. And they also found out that 64% of the 70,000 people had at least one ACE score, and 1 out of 8 people had 4 or more. So this is actually a really big problem, and this data is both very obvious but also very shocking. But to me, it is also very positive because it makes childhood trauma very transparent. And this data is actually going to change things. This is Dr. Nadine Burke-Herrens. She designed treatment protocols to screen every child and heal every child. She's a pediatrician based in San Francisco. And she did that from this research and from this data. So that's what I'm trying to do with my game, Lily. You could also see it as a playful and poetic infographic that aims to frame childhood trauma as a very clear problem, because clear problems can be solved. So, yeah, this is what I'm trying to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlotte. There's another one. Should we do it now? Yes. No. You are ready now? Yeah, I forgot to mention there's another one. But it's the invisible speaker. It's the invisible speaker. But yes. Can I get a stand? The stand, like here. Because our next speaker, I forgot to mention, but there's a good reason for it. Follow me, because it's good. Our next speaker is Michael Straubig, a game designer, creative coder, exploring relationships between systems, games, and playful experiences in various media with a focus on mixed reality and post-human play. He's currently a PhD candidate at Plymouth University, researching playful systems. The thing is that Michael can't be with us today because of some last-minute emergency. So he was very kind. I mean, we discussed. I said, "Okay, if you can make it, things happen. It's not a problem." But he said, "No, no. I would really like to. If it's possible, if you're okay with it, I will send out a recorded presentation. Apparently, in Keynote, there's a feature where you can record a presentation and just play with his voice." And so he did this instead. During the middle, it goes silent for a while. You just see the slides advancing, but it's not an error. It's supposed to be like that. So just enjoy the slides. The talk is about imperfect VR, the concept of imperfect VR. And since Michael is not here in person, I mean, this is a first for me because I never had to introduce a speaker who's not here. So I don't know. I wonder, do we need to clap if he's not here? Maybe not. Do we? But then loud enough that he can hear us. And yes. And also another question, I mean, is the ethics, you know, of like this sort of talks, is like, is it okay to check your phone while somebody who's not here is talking? I don't know, but you will find out. It's a social experiment. So if you want to applaud, you can applaud. Maybe yes, do it. Do it.
We need sound from the laptop from this one.
Yes. So this is about imperfect VR. But before we get started, a short message from our sponsor. Oh, sorry, that's the wrong slide. I wanted to show this one. Obviously. This is Mark Zuckerberg and the future of VR, maybe. I don't know anything about Mark personally. All I know about Mark is from the movie The Social Network. From this movie, we can learn that Facebook was built on Mark's libido. And this is Palmer, friendly nerd, a wunderkind. He brought that second wave of VR that currently washes over us. We all are basking in Palmer. Everybody loves Palmer. Except when we learn that he was secretly funding political shitposting and right-wing hate. Now Palmer is not so loved anymore because hate equals death. And I made this before all this started as a sharky comment on art and VR. But what strikes me more importantly is that VR is a medium through which humans express their issues and needs, be it the designers, the technologists, or the players. And VR is part of a culture that needs to decide where to go. And this is not new, this is 1979. And it makes sense to look at film. It makes sense to look at indie. Indie is sexy. But indie is also dead since 1994. Your indie hero might rip you off while begging Palmer for a free VR headset. And it looks difficult, but it is really simple. From this comes this. Comes this. And VR is about human expression and perception, and as such it does not belong to anyone, not to Facebook, not to Palmer, not to the indie hero. It is a medium for everyone, for those who identify as nerds and coders, but also for those who do not. Imperfect VR is for them, and we need everyone badly, and everyone can make a VR. Thank you.
Well, it was necessary, you know. It's like I don't know. It's performance. It's part. I don't know. I think it was necessary. I don't know. We can let's discuss later. But I mean, maybe we have over a drink this evening. Coming up next, we have Ghost Butter, a games and animation studio consisting of sibling duo Eleanor Kopka, the animator, and Konstantin Kopka, the game developer. Based in, I believe, Leipzig. You still? Okay, good, good. I will visit one day. Thank you. In this talk, they will reveal five ancient truths about ghosts, games, and animation. So let's please welcome on stage Ghost Butter.
This one? Sound from the game? Yes, of course. Ah, yes, I forgot, wait. No, this one? Oh, mirror screen, yes. Do I need to mirror the screen? No, I shouldn't mirror the screen. Come, please come.
Yes,
okay. So tell us a bit about the
Hello.
Setup
Hi.
Here. That's why.
Hi.
This one?
Yeah, it would be.
Hello.
Hi.
What is going to happen now? Why do I need to
okay. Yeah, we're just gonna set up the screen.
Yeah, we can
really
already
quick.
Say the introduction, maybe.
No.
It's all timed.
It's Unity.
It's.
Oh my God.
Just a little note. So our talk changed a tiny little bit. It's not about five ancient truths anymore. Just,
no.
Just so you're not surprised.
Just three ancient.
It's just. Just three truths that are not that ancient. But okay. Hello. Can you hear me? Yeah. Hi. My name is Eleanor. I'm an animator and illustrator. This is my brother Konstantin. He's a game developer. And together we founded a studio for games and animation called Ghost Butter.
So we both studied different things at art school, at the same art school actually. Eleanor studied illustration, I studied painting. And somehow, independently, we found our way to what we're doing right now. So along the way, we did a couple of game jams, and we found out that we actually really like working together a lot. So, because our ideas and what we're trying to convey work very well together. And for this talk today, we decided, instead of making a PowerPoint presentation, to do another game jam. And the results of which we're going to show you today to give you a little bit of, to show you a little bit more what we're all about, what Ghost Butter is all about. So we're going to start. Right now.
So first off, we need ghosts. Ghosts in our games. Our work in general could mean just ghosts, like real ghosts, like those we are just now pulling out of this gentleman's eyes and mouth. But
In another way, it's also about the spirit and the atmosphere that we're trying to create in our work. We both love things that are a little bit spooky, a little bit occult and strange. So ghosts and scary stuff is kind of right up our alley.
Alright, transformations. So we love the feeling of buttery smooth transformations in our games. And what's especially interesting to us is that everything could potentially morph into something else, opening up a new dimension in the game. And also an important part in both of our works is actually like this feeling of fluidity and interactivity. And we also try to give every little part in the game a little bit of physicality so that it feels like it's there or something.
This helps us to create room, perspective, obviously, and also like a possibility to hide surprises. So basically anything could be living under the surface.
That was our talk.
Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed it. And have a nice festival, everyone. See you around.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Eleanor, I really like your art style. Always makes me think, you're welcome. But it always reminds me, I don't know, I like the style, but then it reminds me of like, the 30s and poverty. It makes me think of poverty, you know, in a good way, in a good way. No, it's like the black and white. No, it's the black and white, it's the film grain, this sort of like texture. It's, but it's interesting. It's, I don't know how it is, but yes. But I need to come to Leipzig. Thank you. So, to introduce the next speaker, I want to tell you a story about how I got to meet her. So, there's a bookshop, maybe you remember the story, I don't know, but it's an interesting story, Zoe. So basically there's a bookshop in Berlin called Topics, and some time ago, like a couple of years ago, I signed up to their newsletter. And they made the terrible, for me, mistake of sending the newsletter to all recipients visible. And first time I was like, "Arr!" And the second time this happened, I wrote them the following email. Basically I said, "Can you please stop sending your newsletter with all recipients visible?" I told them how to use BCC. I also told them you can use TinyLetter or MailChimp. And then I told them, but if you intend to continue sending email with all recipients visible, please remove me from your list. So that's me. So this is the one side of me that people don't know about. And the reply was, actually the only possible reply you could do is like, sorry for that, it won't happen again. I think any other answer would have been not good. So yes, best, thank you, Doron. And what happened next? They learn how to use MailChimp or something. So it didn't happen again. So then sometime later, they just send it to me, that's great. But on top of that, I was scrolling down the email and then I saw they had a book, but they were planning to have a book presentation for Critical Hits, an indie gaming anthology, a presentation together with its editor, Zoe Jellico. And so I looked at Zoe's site and I discovered that she now lives in Berlin. So a couple of months ago, we met for coffee and that's when I invited her to give a hyper talk. So it's interesting, you know, no life, you know? I could have just unsubscribed from the from the newsletter, and then you wouldn't be here, you know. So you see. And so, by the way, Zoe has some copies of the Critical Hits book here. Do you? Yes, there is one here, book which you should totally get, and it features several people we had at the festival, one time or the other, like Cara Ellison, Holly Gramazio, Owen Harris, Catherine Neal, Emily Reid. So half of the people we had, the other half we will have soon, and she has lots of copies with her, so go buy one. And so using Heidegger's experience of subject-object relations, which we're all familiar with, as a springboard, Zoe's talk will explore how players interact with digital objects and environments in everything from slow-paced survival horror to absurd surrealist puzzle games. So let's please welcome on stage Zoe Jellicoe.
Hello. Hi. It's probably a bad idea to do a talk on Heidegger over 5 minutes, but we'll see how it goes. So, yes, as Lorenzo said, I have my copy of Critical Hits here, and the talk that I'm going to give is sort of what I cover in my chapter as well. So as he said, yeah, Critical Hits is a collection of essays from 11 really wonderful writers and developers. That's the book. I've got more copies. Come find me afterwards. There we go. This is Martin Heidegger, and I'm going to discuss some of his theories from being and time in relation to games, specifically his approach to object, so objects as defined through use. Heidegger takes, hence the hammer, he takes a classic example of the hammer and argues that an object can be approached in two different ways, so through contemplation or through its use. Once the hammer is wielded, it takes on a new significance, and it has a purpose, and this is its kind of final true being. So Heidegger's understanding of being or existence is in a very active, striving way, and obviously video games kind of represent a perfect opportunity for this, because his idea is that we are defined through our actions, that is, our effect upon the world. So video games then represent this kind of fascinating environment in which to explore objects. Survival horror games, they can be distilled down to their immediate use and become really fetishized. Things like Amnesia, Resident Evil. They're also kind of given new lateral meaning in games like Monkey Island through wordplay, through puns. And then finally, a game that I'm really interested in called Katamari Damacy is where objects are just defined. They're kind of stripped of their aesthetic meaning, stripped of their kind of mundane significance, and they take on this pure meaning just as shape. So, first of all, Katamari Damacy. Katamari Damacy, which you might know, was created by Namco for PlayStation a little while ago. It's a pretty simple premise. You play as Prince Cosmos, and you've been set up with the task of rolling Katamaris with objects around the world to create new constellations. So object in Katamari Damacy is, as I said, like broken down to its kind of most basic purpose. So you end up like taking watermelons, merpeople, living and non-living objects, and they're all sort of starting from the same baseline. The game represents a really interesting counterpoint to the way that we usually interact with objects in the world and in games, because it's just use or purpose is kind of devoid of meaning in a certain way. And there's this incredible interconnectedness through the world because everything is at the same level. The game kind of creates this pure shape-centric world that's really meditative. It's a lot like Tetris. It also has one of the best soundtracks I've ever heard. And this whole like living things made objects is something I became really interested in. I'll talk about a little more in a second. So as I said, the thing I liked about this was that everything becomes quite interconnected, because the way that we experience, the objects that we experience in the world have a kind of interconnectedness through their use. So for example, like a glass of water is kind of connected to humans through liquid, through its source, as well as through its ultimate purpose. And then in Katamari Damacy, the varied interconnections of our world are sort of broken down to this one aspect, which is their rollability, how easily they can be rolled. Which results in a sort of kind of non-traditional objects having a pure usability, so everything just becomes much more literally connected. Next, I'm going to talk about Monkey Island, specifically LeChuck's Revenge. You're probably familiar with this game. You play as Guybrush Threepwood, who kind of travels around the Monkey Island universe solving puzzles. In this particular instance, you have to kidnap this monkey, Jojo, who plays piano in a bar called the Bloody Lip and Grill on Scab Island. And you use him as a monkey wrench to get into the Fat Island waterfall. Here then, what's interesting is that an object is not simply abstracted from its original former purpose, but this animal as object kind of recalls Heidegger's idea of objects as equipment. So things having this lateral meaning as opposed to their kind of ultimate use. Obviously very problematic that it's a monkey kind of being abstracted here. And yes, so finally, game that I recently became interested in, and he's also exhibiting here at the moment, is Jesse Barksdale's game, The Static Speaks My Name, which sort of takes this idea of like living thing as object to its ultimate conclusion, so human as object. For those who aren't familiar with the game, we're sort of drawn into this world, the final moments of Jacob Erhardt's. So we wake up in his house, and we're quickly tasked with the idea of like feeding ourselves, and you wake up next to an aquarium full of live prawns, which are labeled my babies, and this is how you feed yourself. And everything goes pretty downhill from there, as you can see. So you sort of chat online to people, and you end up electrocuting this painter that you've presumably abducted. You're obsessed with his paintings. And what's interesting is that in each encounter, there are no choices. There's only an immediate kind of overarching purpose. So ultimately, this kind of use noose is the kind of final act of the game. Heidegger has quite conflicted ideas about suicide. He's obviously against it, but the way that Dasein is designed, Dasein means existence and being. And every sort of moment in which we're being, we're also kind of being towards death. Dasein actually kind of means the inevitability of a being towards death. So this kind of final moment represents like a sort of unnatural authenticity, because it's this ultimate act of killing oneself. In Heidegger's ideas, the nullification of the world's possibilities, but at the same time, the kind of the only real ultimate thing that can happen. Anyway, yeah, death. thank you very much, and please get the book. I promise it's not all about death. Thanks.
Thank you. I like how the talk ends on a positive note.
Yeah.
We forgot to mention something. Are you looking for work?
No. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm also hireable. I'm a writer.
Editor.
And an editor. I write about things other than death.
Yes. So yeah. Go talk with Zoe. Thank you. Don't fall. Attention. Thank you. Yes. Stop. Hello. Our next speaker is Paulina. Not Marius. Paulina. Sorry. I missed. Paulina Vera. How do you call it? Schmidt. Whatever. An indie QA. Who's been testing games since 2007, now works for Robot Gentleman and owns Rudy Ziobak, professional QA for Indies. And she will tell us three stories from her game testing career with a very clear message, learn stuff. So let's please welcome on stage Paulina.
Let's go. That's like my only screen for this presentation, so you're not gonna get any more of that. I'm a professional game tester. It means that I'm one of those creatures that sit in the basement and play games all day. But actually, if you spend any time actually doing QA for game industry, you probably know that game testers are one of the least credited, least appreciated people in game dev. But the thing is that if you want to be a professional tester, you have to know everything about creating games. And I mean everything, because you have to know about design, graphics, sounds, and stuff. But sometimes you need to have an additional knowledge. And I'm going to describe three bugs that I found thanks to this additional knowledge. The first one, some guys decided to put some pop culture characters into their game, but they didn't have a license for that, so they decided to change the names of those characters. So, for example, there was Harry Wizard, something like that. But then they had this character, Oscar the Grouch from the Sesame Street. But the thing that they didn't realize, they didn't change the name at all. It was just Oscar. So thanks to my knowledge of the Sesame Street, they didn't have a lawsuit thanks to me watching Sesame Street when I was a kid. The second one, there was a car in a game set in America, and the license plates had some additional letter or number in there, something like that. And they didn't noticed it because they weren't American, so they just put like random license plates there. But I was watching way too many Fast and Furious series at that time, so I was able to spot this one additional sign at the license plates. And the third one, it was a boxing game. There was a pre-fight scenery when the boxers were going out to the stage. And they had those ropes, and there was one rope like Japanese style. It has Japanese patterns and something like that. And on the sleeve, there was the name of the game written in katakana. That's like Japanese signs. What they didn't realize, it was mirror view of that. It was kind of difficult to spot for a person who doesn't know any Japanese. And I saw that, and the artist had a really bad day that day. Actually, they decided to leave it because that was discovered so late in a production, so it's still in the game. But my father always was wondering why I learn Japanese, because there are not many Japanese people in Poland, so why do you need it? I like it. So actually, all those three bugs might have been discovered by accident, but then you never know what knowledge you can use. This time it was me being a kid and watching Sesame Street. It was me finding Vin Diesel very handsome fella, and then again Sesame Street special episode Big Bird in Japan. That day, after watching that, I decided that I like Japan, I want to learn Japanese. So, all in all, you never know what knowledge you can use. So, learn stuff. Thanks.
Thank you. So I always have notes. Well, I have a few notes. Now I'm kind of improvising, Alf. I can take the liberty of improvising here without the notes because I know our next speaker a little bit, Marius. So first of all, Marius already spoke at the Maze a couple, 2-3 years ago, back once upon a time when it was part of the Major Bueno duo. And right now, Marius is a game designer at Studio Fitzbin, and we both work in the same space called Saftladen here in Berlin. It's a shared working space and indie game collective. And we also have an open day on Saturday. If you want to come, let me know. I can send an invite. And one day over lunch, we went out for lunch together because we're in the same office, and we were discussing about some of these projects he's been doing over the years. So Marius over the years has been making games based on existing games, such as Monkey Island, Alone in the Dark, or Firewatch. And so we were talking about this stuff, and I told him, you should give a talk about this stuff. And so you should come to Amaze and do a hyper talk about why you're doing games based on existing games. And yes, so that's basically why he's here. So I guess we should welcome on stage Marius Winter.
Hello, I'm Marius Winter, and I like to do fan projects. Great, you should do Hypertalk. Fan art? More like fan heart. So here's a picture of me. I'm a game designer at Studio Fitzbin. I previously made Major Bueno games with Benedikt Hummel, and in between, I make fan projects. Fan projects are great because so many elements of a project are already done. You don't have to come up with the world, the characters, and stories. But fan projects are also tricky because you can't make money off it, and or you can't call those projects completely yours. You might even say sometimes maybe they are a waste of time and energy, but we all still do them. And here are my reasons, or a couple of reasons why I like to do fan projects. So, one reason I do fan project is to learn something. I learned animating. I learned Adobe Flash through the Monkey Island Flash movie I made 10 years ago. The movie was the perfect training ground for the clumsy, fast-paced, quick and dirty storytelling in that movie. And so, yeah, it fitted perfectly to start drawing and animating in Flash. Another project that teaches me a lot is Firewatch Suited. I'm currently working on that. It's not released. I started it recently. It's a fast-paced, interactive retelling of Firewatch, another game my heart is extra juicy about. And the project is my first time working in Unity on my own. And since I don't know how to code, I installed the Playmaker plugin. So I want to experience the fascinating challenge of designing a seemingly simple dialogue system, building a landscape that is handmade but also needs to appear natural, and how to tell a linear story in a presumably open world. Basically, the trigger to that project was the audio commentary of Firewatch, which is really fascinating. So okay, this is a huge project. It's really big, bigger than I thought, and I don't know if I will be able to finish it, but that is completely fine, because the previous efforts paid off big time already. I can prototype in Unity now. That is so cool. And actually, there is already a game that was born out of my first learning steps in Firewatch Suited, which is Malone in the Dark, a fan project of Alone in the Dark. I made it with my friend Nick, and who also just started learning Unity and Playmaker, and together, without coding knowledge, we made this happen, and already dream of our next game. So yeah, that was really cool. Another reason why I do fan projects is to get a job. Because 2012, I made a playable application for an internship at Double Fine. However, I see this application as a fan project first. The project fulfilled my desire to do Monkey Island-related stuff again, because I love Monkey Island. And yeah, the art style is a tribute to the old crispy pixel 1990 look of the game. So I studied closely how the original got made and dived deep into the sprite sheets of the classic. And yeah, while it was stressful making this game because I really needed Double Fine to want me as an intern, at the same time it was also a fulfilling geeky history lesson on my favorite game series. And I got the job, which was also cool. But here's the reason why I love to do fan projects is to have fun. Which sounds like an obvious thing. Of course, we want to have fun doing something. But while writing this talk, I realized how strict I am about it. Like, I just say, tell myself I need to have fun or I don't make it. For example, I made those Breaking Bad comics while the last season was airing, and it was a really great time, mainly because it's so much fun drawing Walter White. Now, the new season of the spin-off series Better Call Saul is running, and I love Better Call Saul. I love this show. I love it even more than Breaking Bad. And I actually have ideas for a couple comics and jokes, and I should do them, really should do them, but I probably won't make it because it's so hard drawing Saul Goodman. It's just really hard, and I'm ashamed showing you this, but I have to make a point, right? So, my point is, now I could sit down and don't be lazy and learn how to draw Saul. I could get to that point. I could invest hard work into it to get it right, and I could maybe succeed and make good comics because now the new season is running. It's the perfect timing. But in my eyes, that would mean that the project would be defined by hard work. And I don't want that. I want my work to be defined by my passion, by my time having a blast making them. So I only choose projects that exhilarate me right from the start. It sounds super picky and spoiled, but it's kind of my insurance that I will make something that is truly by me. So yes, these are a couple. That's a lot I get out of fan projects. So many emotions that fulfill me. They inspire me and improve me. And yeah, and all that I can also now channel towards other unique projects. Long story short, fan projects are far away from a waste of time and energy. Fiverr. Yeah, great ending. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye. Ciao. Thank you. Thank you, Marius. So, final, our 10th speaker. So basically, as I said, this is the fourth year I'm hosting the HyperTalks, and this is the third year. So we have this tradition now with the HyperTalks where we usually end, the last talk is something completely different. And this year is no exception. So I think like last year we had like talk about crowd games where we played a crowd game with the crowd. And the year before we had 10 members, the 10 members of the Klondike Collective plus an intruder on stage, more or less 30 seconds each. And one of these 10 speakers was Pitum here, who's particularly interested in procedurally generated text contents. And today he will give us a procedural talk. So let's welcome on stage Pitum. Wait. Oh, yes. Go. Go. Come. I did this for you. It's a procedural generated applause. It's one of my favorites, like trace effect. Is it a bit too long? Yeah. I mean, I set it to 30 minutes, so it's like taking a bit. So now we have to wait until, look at that, look at technology. It's there, it's almost there. So now we need to set, we need to move to Firefox. I always complicate my life, like, you know, I'm too good, you know, because I'm always like, whatever people ask me, the speakers, if you ask me, can we have a cow on stage? I will say, yeah, it's tricky, but we can make it happen. So instead of a cow, we have Firefox. Let's, one second.
Hi. Oh, okay, so I have to talk. Yeah, it's gonna be an experiment. I will talk to you about it in a few seconds, probably. Okay, I can do clap dance, the tap dance, sorry. No, I'm not good at that. So, hey, perfect. No, we don't care about the sound. It's shitty, so perfect. It's better without it. Okay, so hi everyone.
Wait.
Yeah.
Wait.
Okay. Now? Yeah, perfect. So, this is a procedural small-sized conference or talk. The idea is I'm really interested in procedural generated text. I'm looking into that for 2 or 3 years now, and I was thinking about, hey, maybe I can do like a conference or a talk that I don't know before doing it. Like, I have no idea what I'm going to talk about, except the few first slides. So, yeah, why would you do that? Because it's fun, probably, like everything we do here. The first thing, just those are not procedurally generated, just for you to know. I made a first game about procedurally generated text, which was Minmilia. If you saw the literature playful talk this morning by Pierre Corbinet, he talks about procedurally generated poems in literature in France, and I made a game about that, so you can check it. I made also Poetry, which is an app you can download. It's about procedural small poems. So here is an example. Confusion is a mountain of knife. It writes you in an exotic way, probably. Another example, filthy nebula, drop of fear, fun theory. Yeah. So it's just an app. You can download it, and you will have like, yeah, a lot of weird sentences that you can share after that. Yeah. So let's begin the talk and let's see what happens. Vegetarian in speeches, a new shame. Yeah, of course. So I'm a vegetarian, actually, and I don't speak a lot of about it in talks because it has nothing to do with video games generally, and I do it with clothes on me, because when I'm going naked in the street, it's weird and people throw things at me. So, yeah, not very good idea to do so. Let's see another slide. How me? Okay, sometimes English is not good, but it's because I'm French. How me do help to make serendipity cute? Do you know what serendipity is? Probably not. Serendipity is about what I like in procedurally generated thing. It's things that happen and they weren't planned, like something like a bug or something like that. And in procedurally generated text, you sometimes have very weird combination that can be very poetic, very funny, and that's what I'm looking for in all these things. So, yeah, it can be crude. Probably. Sex, ludonarrative dissonance, and poetry. Profits? So, I should say no, but it's because I'm a very bad marketing guy. My app is free, and there is no advertisement in it, but there is sex in it, so you can have a lot of poem about sex. And there is ludonarrative dissonance because it's a thing. And we should talk about that. 30-second pitch. Okay, a game about limitation in a circle. Okay, it could be a game about a cat, because I don't know if you saw those videos on the internet, on YouTube. You can see cats, and you draw a circle around them, and they cannot cross the circle. So I don't know if it's a real thing, because I'm allergic to cats, so I cannot try it. But we can make a game about that. So you are a cat and you have to cross a circle, but for some weird reason you cannot do so. I think it's a great idea for a game, like $1 million idea. The two things I like about players. Shit. Probably they are not around me when they are playing my games. It's a good thing. And sometimes they pay me, but that's not a lot of them. When I make books, I wrote 2 books, actually, 10 years ago. I should definitely make another one. Last one, the 25 quadrillion things I like about sexism. How long is this talk, Lorenzo? Okay. Yeah, but I think it's nice to finish on this one, if that's okay. So I will probably make a game about that. No man sexism or something like that. So thank you very much. It was... No. No, let's begin. So thank you very much. I am Pitum, and it was a procedural talk.
Yeah, let's... Wait. What happens now? No. Well, in Sonic games, yes. In our rings, yes. It's hard. Oh, it's hard. Yeah. Not easy. Good. No, good. But it was good. I thought I could pull it off, but no. I can only do scripted jokes. I'm bad. Thank you, Pitum. Thank you. Ciao. Ooh. I think more or less that was it. I think it was a good use of our time. We saw 10 different talks about different topics. We learned new stuff. We met new interesting people. I have a new iPhone. So not too bad. I mean, for me, it's like... And so thanks for coming. I hope you had fun. 1 second, can we have the sound from the laptop in a second? Just make sure. And now, when we leave now, please go talk with our hyper speakers, buy their games, their books, and hire them for your projects, buy them drinks, do something. And I want to leave you with some words from a famous German poet, which said, sit there, be good, bye-bye.
It's so beautiful to see your head.